Kalaleichem Rabbi Sai, this is Yehuda Levin. The program is a program that makes 1 hour a week. If you're going to invest it in radio, this is the place to be. The program is 11 at 11, in which we catalog the devolving culture and some of the bright spots in what's happening in our community in light of the Hashkov of Gedol Yisrael of yesteryear. Without further ado,
Rabbi.
Yes, hi,
Rabbi,
how are you?
Having me. Yes. Yeah, okay, you gotta speak up a little bit. I want to tell you that we have on Rabbi, is it Reuven Yaron?
Yaron Reuven.
I always get it mixed up with him. Yaron Reuven, who has a tremendous presence on the internet, and he's doing tremendous, tremendous things. It's very, very inspiring, and I want to tell you, I say this, I have a love-hate relationship with you. I love what you're doing, and I hate your guts, because after 120 years, when I come upstairs, you know, like Hills Machayev Daniim, they're going to bring you out, and they're going to smack me around. They're going to say, look what this year accomplished over here. So I have a love-hate relationship with you, but I'm trying to ameliorate this and make it a little easier by inviting you onto the radio program, so I'll be able to tell God, look, but I put him on the radio. You know, I try to view him, pass him his message. So here's the deal. What you do is you have different things, different videos of people that you call heretical. That means you feel that they're saying apikursis, amaratus, downright kafir, etc., etc. And like you said, you're not involved politically correct in the Haredi community here in New York, etc. You're not a member of so to speak, of Aguda, of this or that. You have to tiptoe. You don't have a moshe to yeshiva. You're allowed to say exactly what you feel. So tonight, I want to focus tremendously. He has a tremendous. He's been raising his profile tremendously in the Haredi community. The rabbi of Boca Raton, Ephraim Goldberg, who is at Black Velvet Yarmulke, he's a YU Talmud, and it would be much better off, I told you right away, if he was here at Kippah Sruga, because psychologically people would relate to him in a different way, but he wears that Haredi yarmulke, etc., etc. And so to the outside, you know, even on his behind the bima weekly or whatever it is, the YouTube extravaganza, his other two co-pilots are younger than him, and they wear kippah sruga. Everybody knows in modern Orthodox Finnish business, but he comes across, etc. And that's dangerous because I believe he's done a lot of things to mislead people, but particularly 5 years ago, you got involved with him, in particular when you lived in Boca Raton at the time, and he was having an event in his synagogue where his guest speaker, and you mentioned that guest speaker might have even been paid several tens of thousands of dollars because it seems it's an affluent congregation, or some members are affluent, and that person who he invited to speak as part of a program was a downright Catholic missionary, even though most Catholics don't evangelize and missionize. This one is a missionary, and you brought proof of this, and you waged a tremendous war to see to it that this shouldn't take place. And so pick up the story from there. I know you got the chief rabbi, Rabbi Yitzchak Yosef, involved to tell Rabbi Ephraim Goldberg to read him a little bit the Riot Act.
Right. So what ended up happening is that I lived in Boca Raton. I was attending that synagogue, Boca Raton Synagogue, and met a lot of different people. Some people were really nice. Some people, not so much. But nonetheless, just like every other community, there's pros and cons. The one thing I never understood is what's the big deal about this Ephraim Goldberg that everybody was worshiping him practically. Everyone was afraid of him. And one day, he actually even invited me to his house one time for Shabbat. And, they seemed like relatively simple people. I just never really understood the big deal. But then when I saw what happened with this whole parasha, when he invited a Catholic missionary, and everybody was afraid to respond, even though they agreed that this is wrong. So initially, when I saw this, I double-checked. It took me 2 seconds to figure out this guy's a Catholic missionary. I sent an email to Ephraim Goldberg and told him that, maybe you misunderstood, or maybe you didn't check. But the guy you're inviting to speak about the purpose of life, that was the topic of the lecture, of this seminar, is a Catholic missionary that wrote a book, Rediscover Jesus, that in that book, it says, love Nero, love Hitler, love Bin Laden, and pray for them. Okay, this is the guy that you're actually inviting to your synagogue.
What was the stated purpose of his inviting him?
To teach about the purpose of life. That was the topic of the lecture. Purpose of life.
Okay, go ahead, Rabbi. Go ahead.
So he was looking to bring him. We actually later found out that he paid him $44,000 to come. And the topic was the purpose of life. That was the topic. Now, after I brought this to his attention, he was nonchalant about it. He kept telling me that he's not going to talk about religion. He's going to talk about the purpose of life. I'm not really sure how the two are different. But nonetheless, we went back and forth. I realized that I'm getting nowhere with this guy. I told him that I'm going to expose this to the public. I'm not going to stay silent. He thought that I'm a nobody, so he didn't really care so much. And then we made a very, very loud, obnoxious public war, making lectures about it, videos about it. People got motivated. Some people, started calling the synagogue. Some people started calling the missionary. It went really wild all over the place. There was a lot of noise online. Some people in the community that agreed were too scared to do anything about it. And some people actually agreed with Ephraim Goldberg, supporting him, saying that I'm a crazy fanatic, psychopath, that, I should be pro driving on Shabbat, just like Ephraim Goldberg, where he has, 200-300 cars driving on Shabbat to his Beit Knesset to come pray. And they look just like him with that black yarmulke. But nonetheless, obviously we know what the Torah says. We know this is forbidden. And in a place, the Gemara Masechet Sanhedrin says that in a place that is Chilul Hashem, there is no honor for the rabbi. So we had, entire lecture full of Torah details of why this thing is forbidden. You're not even allowed to be within 6 feet of a missionary, according to Halacha. He's a Machti Arabim. The point is that this was really loud. We tried to get public support. We got this public support. The tough part was getting rabbinical support, because in the rabbinical world, there's a lot of politics. So, when it came down to getting signatures, people were scared to sign first. Long story short, we eventually got Rav Shmuel Kamenetsky to sign a letter, forsaking this event and condemning it. We also got Rabbi Yitzhak Yosef also condemned it and actually called Ephraim Goldberg and threatened to remove his rabbinical connection to the Rabbanut in Israel. Now, all of that did nothing. All of that did nothing. And the reason why is because Ephraim Goldberg upped the ante. He changed the name of the event, still same missionary, changed the name of the event, and made it free so more people could attend. Initially, it was a paid event. You were supposed to pay $200-$300 to come. He made it a free event for everybody to come. So he upped the ante. He was completely ignoring everything else. He's going to be told what to do by nobody. He's a person that's a Baal Gava to the highest possible extent. And long story short, this was a disaster. But Hashem had mercy on us that after we tried so much, for literally for a couple of months, day and night, working the phones and doing all types of things, eventually, the missionary, Matthew Kelly, that is pro-Hitler, pro-Nero, pro-Osama bin Laden, says you should pray for them, and his whole job is to convert people to Christianity. That guy got scared. He called Ephraim, and he told him, I quit. I'm not doing it. This is, it seems to be like a dangerous situation. People are calling me. They're bothering me. I'm not coming. And he canceled it. Ephraim Goldberg writes a blog to report that the missionary canceled it and says that he cried with tears when the missionary canceled the event. Now, I don't know if he cries about Chorban Beit HaMikdash. I don't know if he cries when the next-door neighbor that he was friends with was raping the child in the community for many years. I don't know if he cried when my next-door neighbor died of an overdose a couple of weeks after I left. I'm not sure if he died when my other neighbor begged him to allow him to go to a yeshiva, but he couldn't afford it. And Ephraim Goldberg told him that he should just send the Jewish boy to a public school because he can't afford yeshiva. I'm not sure if he cried on all of these things, but I do know that he should cry about what type of Gehinnom he's going to get. Now, the problem is that even though this happened, and it got canceled, and we had a little a celebration for a half a second. The perpetrator was still there, and he continued bringing more heretics to the synagogue, such as Shmuley Butech, that's pro-homosexuality, Nathan Slifkin, that has his books banned by every Gdolah Dor, the Broward Pastors Network, which is, he brings, different priests to the actual synagogue, a Mayor Kay that had has a video online that where he takes two guys that were formerly homeless, they're homosexuals, and he gets them a room and he says, this is a time for you guys to celebrate your love together, and he's supposed to be an Orthodox Jew.
Lubavitcher, yes.
Yeah.
Yeah, so go ahead,
go ahead. The guy is promoting a lot of Reshaim, and so he's there. So now, the community apparently is swallowing this up, and nobody's really doing much, even though there are some people that disagree. Now, we continue to follow what's going on. One of the things that we did notice is that, despite the fact that the event was canceled, some of Ephraim Goldberg's friends took notes from him and started following his teaching. So a guy by the name of Rabbi Shaul Robinson, who is the head rabbi in the Lincoln Square Synagogue, it's an Orthodox shul, he learned under the same teachers as Ephraim Goldberg. They're friends. They both have the same rabbi, which is Kenneth Brander and Shlomo Riskin, two heretics that are pro-homosexuality and distort the Torah on a regular basis. These two guys are pretty much the fathers of a lot of different heretics. And this Shaul Robinson, he actually brought a Pastor Jacques de Graaf to give a Musar teachings to his Jewish community in Manhattan about, a year and a half, two years ago, that he thought that we should learn Musar from the pastors. Kenneth Brander, obviously, he's the guy that was the head of the Boca Raton Synagogue before Ephraim Goldberg was, but he gave the job to Ephraim Goldberg because he had a much better job that he got from their rabbi, which is Shlomo Riskin, running this heretical organization that he has in Israel, where they have an interfaith educational program where they want to teach the Christians and the Jews all together under the auspices of Or Torah Institution. That's what they call it. The Or Torah, and now they have this program. And one of the things that they teach is, again, the Shlomo Riskin's famous YouTube video that says that when he sees the Mashiach, as if the Mashiach will see him, he sees the Mashiach, he's going to ask the Mashiach if it's the first time that he came or the second time. So this Shlomo Riskin goes to Kenneth Brander, who's the one of the rabbis for Ephraim Goldberg, and then the other Talmidim are bringing, the priests and the missionaries to the synagogues. Now, the update is, since this was not enough to stop Ephraim, on January 11th, in just the next couple of weeks, Ephraim Goldberg is making a major event where he's calling South Florida Night to celebrate Israel, where he's bringing Pastor Mario Bremnick to speak to his community alongside with Ambassador David Friedman. And now Pastor Mario Bremnick is an active missionary. There's a YouTube video out there where he specifically says that his number one target is the Jewish people. He's not looking for goyim. He's looking for Jews. And he himself is actually a Jew, according to Halakha, but he considers himself a Christian. Your conquerors, your destroyers will come from within you, of course. We're our own worst enemy. So this Mario Bremnick is coming to the Boca Raton Synagogue unless something is done. Unless Hashem has mercy on us, he's coming. And that's
Mike, can you just mention briefly that they have these mixed Torah classes with the Galachim and some of these rabbis?
Not only do they have the mixed Torah classes, if you look at the BRS YouTube channel, you'll see that the women teach for 40 minutes to an hour. Their videos are 40 minutes to an hour. The men, 3 minutes. The videos by the men, by the rabbis, the so-called rabbis, are usually 3 minutes, 3.5 minutes, if it's a real big chidush. If it's really a chashuv, it's Yamim Noraim, you want to do tshuva for Elul, the rabbi teaches for 3.5 minutes on their YouTube channel. But the women, average class is about 40 minutes to an hour. It's a completely distorted place. And the truth is that Ephraim doesn't listen to anybody. He says that you know, that he has connections to big rabbis, but he never mentions who. But then he also invites Rabbi Arshel Shechter to his synagogue a couple of times a year. And he says that Rabbi Shechter is actually his rabbi. The problem is that Rabbi Shechter actually wrote an article some years ago called Experimental Judaism, Playing with Fire, where he specifically condemns working together and uniting with the Christian church and inviting him to synagogues and doing anything with them for that matter. So obviously he's just, you know, Ephraim doesn't listen to anybody aside from his own ego, aside from his own agenda. I'm not even sure what his agenda is. He's probably looking to become, I don't know, some type of politician. But he has a very, very close relationship with the church, much closer than he does with Orthodox Judaism. And the problem is that he has 1,000 families. It's a very big keilah. 1,000 families in his community, about 500-600 people show up to synagogue on Shabbat. About probably half of them are driving on Shabbat, but nonetheless, a lot of people are showing up. They're all Jews. And this guy's bringing a Christian missionary for not the first and not even the second time. He's brought them in other times.
And just tell me this, because we're running out of time. So there's another Nakuda over here. Rumor has it that he might be considered for the top leadership position in the National Modern Orthodox Rabbinic Organization, the Rabbinical Council of America.
Right. So, yeah. So Ephraim is connected to the OU. He's connected with the ORB. He's connected with RCA. And some people are saying that he is poised to become the next leader of the RCA, which is obviously going to be a major chilul Hashem, a guy that's promoting Christianity. This is completely forbidden. I mean, there's a Shulchan Aruch that specifically says it's forbidden to even listen to anybody that's considered a mean, say anything, even if he's saying divrei Torah. If you look at Yoreh Be'ah in the Siman 179, you'll see over there that in the that it specifically says you can't learn anything, even Torah, from an amgushi. And Amgushi, the Gemara says, is a pastor, is a Christian missionary. You're not allowed to learn anything from him. And the Shulchan Aruch paskins that it would be a death penalty, a heavenly death penalty on the entire Keilah. Needless to say, a spiritual death penalty during this life. This guy's bringing.
I just want to mention so the Olim should know that that he has his insidious entree into Brooklyn and New York Orthodoxy as well. He does it through his videos on the internet with quote unquote interesting guests. Some of them are Pete Corson, as you mentioned before, called Behind the Bema. And another thing he does is they have the Views, Alan Hirsch's The Views newspaper, which has a lot of different Torah in it. And he has in the weekly or every couple of weeks, he has a Torah column there. So it's right here. His tentacles are sticking right here to New York. And I felt it was very important to have the rabbi on because it's important to understand that this is just part of the malaise that is impacting on this taruvos of things in the Haredi community mixed up with all kinds of garbage now. Wow. And we have 1 minute left, so I want to wish you, Rebbe, a lot of continued success, Chazak Baruch, for what you're doing, because you're not Sarkeneged Kulam, for all those who are not protesting, and you're the one that's making it clear. And I want the thousands of people listening to know who this person is. So you definitely shouldn't be mishtayach to his players or be impressed by his personality or his guests or anything else. And Rabbi Reuven, this is just the beginning because we plan to have you on in the future. And another thing that you're doing, we don't even have time to discuss it, but it's applicable that you hear Shaivim and what's going on in Klal Yisrael this week, because you also speak a lot about Tikkun HaYisrael, Tikkun HaBris, and you're having a significant impact on people in this area. And for this, we thank you as well. So we wish you a Tzlacha.
אני מברך את הרבנים, רגע. אני מברך את הרבנים, הרב ירון ראובן, הרב אפרים כחלון, ראשי ארגון בעזרת השם, שהלכו בפיוניון, שעלו מעלה מעלה, יהיה להם ברכה והצלחה. הקדוש ברוך הוא ימלא משאלות ליבם לטובה ולברכה. שבכל מה שיפנו, ישכילו ויצליחו. יזכירו עוד לעשות כאלה וכאלה, הודיעו תורה לאדירה, אמן ואמן.
בעזרת השם רשת בכל הארץ. הוא היהודי הזה, הוא היה מיליונר, סגר את כל הביזנס, אמר אני משקיע פה בעולמה של תורה.
איפה הוא גר?
בפלורידה.
פלורידה, איפה זה פלורידה? אמריקה.
במיאמי.
כן, ליד. אנחנו שם עכשיו הולכים להקים קהילה ספרדית גדולה. קהילה ספרדית גדולה.
תאמין לו מה שבירכתי אותו.
כן, קהילה ספרדית גדולה.
כן.